Okay, welcome. We're talking about posterior urethral valves. And this is a persistent urogenital membrane which occurs in the posterior urethra. The condition is a condition of the males. Most authors say it occurs in males only, but there are some authors who say that the condition rarely occurs in females. It is types 1 and 3. There was a type 2, but it's no longer being considered an entity. So type 1 is the commonest. It occurs in 95% of the cases. And type 3 occurs in 5% of the cases. So the condition can be diagnosed antenatally or postnatally. So antenatally, if a scan is done, it may show oligohydramnios. What happens is that the posterior urethral valves, they block the flow of urine from the bladder to the urethra. So we know that amniotic fluid is contributed from urine. So in antenatal period, if there is posterior urethral valves, that can cause oligohydramnios. So there will be low amniotic fluid. And also the scan can show a hydronephrosis, which is the distinction of the kidneys from accumulation of fluid. And the bladder will be distended, and it can have a thickened wall. So the thickened wall is from hypertrophy. As the bladder contracts, it actually hypertrophies. Then there is a keyhole sign which occurs. This is because of the urethra is distended at the proximal part, but as it approaches the valves, it's then obstructed. So it forms what looks like a keyhole. Okay, it's a distended part and the smaller thin part. So usually after birth, the symptoms that you can see for a male infant is weak stream. Okay, so their stream is not as strong, and sometimes you can ask the mother to say, does the baby sometimes pee on your face, or how is the stream? Because a normal stream in a male should be strong and should be shooting. So if it's a weak stream, it could be a sign. And there is also failure to thrive, which can occur because this condition can cause problem with renal failure and other problems. Then they can present with fast breathing. And fast breathing is because oligohydramnios, which occurs in utero, can cause lung hypoplasia. So amniotic fluid is very essential for the development of the lungs. So if you have to examine the patient, you may find that they may have bimanually palpable masses in both flanks, and these are the kidneys. They will be actually, you can actually feel the kidneys. The bladder will be full. If you measure their blood pressure, it will be high for age, and they can be anemic, so they may actually need blood transfusion. They will, in some cases, will have respiratory distress if they have pulmonary hypoplasia, and they may actually have signs of heart failure depending on the time at which they are presenting, and heart failure can be secondary to the pulmonary hypoplasia. They have tendency to present with urinary tract infections, and they can also have vesicoureteric reflux, and the bladder may be dysfunctional. Okay, so those are the basics for that. So if the patient presents, you need to investigate the patient. So like we said, the patient can be anemic, so you need a full blood count. You need a use a NICE to check for renal function. Most of these patients will need dialysis if they are being diagnosed in the infant period. Or we also need arterial blood gases to check for acidosis, and to check also, since these patients are prone to hypoxia with pulmonary hypoplasia, we want to check that. And a chest x-ray to check for the lungs as well. Then ultrasound scan of the abdomen can help us to just visualize the hydronephrosis, and to check maybe the cortical thickness and other things of the kidneys. But definitive diagnosis would need a micturating cystoid urethrogram. Okay, there are other studies that can be done, like a radionuclide scans. But the problem with this DMSA or MAC3 is that you need the patient first to have a normal creatinine if you are going to be having to be doing those studies. So most likely you will only be able to do a micturating cystoid urethrogram, because the radionuclide study may be contraindicated in patients that have kidney disease. So at birth, there is management that is instituted, or at diagnosis, postnatally, you can start management by first you need to relieve the obstruction. So you catheterize the patient with a nasal gastric tube. Usually catheter size 5, and we don't use a Foley's catheter because we don't want a something that's going to dilate. Because if you dilate your balloon with a Foley's catheter, you can actually worsen the obstruction. And then after catheterization of the NG tube, there is usually post-obstructive diuresis. So there will be loss of fluids, and it's going to lead to electrolyte derangement. So you need also to watch for that and to rehydrate accordingly. Then in centers where a valve lost plastic or valve ablation cannot be done in the acute period, a viscosotomy can be done. And viscosotomy is just an opening on the bladder to the external world, and this will allow urine to drain from the bladder directly to the surface. Then definitive treatment can be done when the patient is older and the stable. It depends on the center's approach and the presence of experts, anesthetists, and surgeons. So if a valve phlebotomy or a valve ablation can be done endoscopically, if the patient, depending on the patient's age and the center where the patient is being treated at. In some advanced centers, antenatally, posterior urethral valves can actually be treated with a fetal posterior urethral valve ablation, so it can actually be done antenatally. And also a vesico amniotic shunt can be done where the bladder, a shunt is connected to the bladder which drains the fluid to the amniotic fluid. The downfall with that is that usually the kidney function is not resolved, but it helps with the development of the lungs. Then the amnio infusion, you can do an amnio infusion to try and increase the amount of amniotic fluid, since we said this patient may actually have oligodromos, and this will help to make the lungs to develop better. All right, thank you.